Today's show is sponsored by Profit Accumulator, the UK's number one match betting service. So what is match betting? It's a method that's used by individuals to profit from free bets and incentives offered by bookmakers. And when you sign up to Profit Accumulator, they will walk you through how to do match betting with their easy to follow video guide. So what are you waiting for? Click the link in the description and you can start your Profit Accumulator journey today. Hi and welcome along to the All Guns Blazing podcast with my man DT in the building, brought to you today by Profit Accumulator. Remember, if you want to earn yourself some extra cash in these tough times, get involved with Profit Accumulator. If you click the link in the description, they show you how to do it, how, you know, they go for everything, right? So make sure you click that link in the description if you're interested. DT, we are here and I think we can say that the season the other night was saved.
Yeah.
Right? Because we were looking at the season ending, basically. You was on the stream and you said, I think you said on the stream, if we don't win, you ain't even coming back for the rest of the season.
Nah. Because I just didn't see the point. The league's done.
Yeah, and everybody was on the stream was saying, oh, this is a bit of a double-edged sword, you know what I mean? Because number one, we want to get rid of him until the end of the season. We don't want to see his face. But then on the other hand, we do want to win a trophy.
You're such a mug. You're lucky I'm in such a good mood after that result. But, seriously.
But no, seriously, our season.
Mate.
Which basically that game the other night against Slavia Prague was... Lose that, season over.
Mm-hmm.
Lose that, Mikel Arteta. A lot of fans were saying, you're over too.
Mm.
And not only did they win it, they won it in emphatic fashion. Going to a ground where, you know, and playing a team that are unbeaten.
Mm.
I know everyone's going to say, you know, I've seen some of the comments after, all right, well, yeah, it was easy. It's expected. No, hold on. That was a pressurized game.
Mm.
They beat Leicester, who this season... Leicester have been better than us.
Mm.
They beat Leicester, right, over two legs. They beat the champions of Scotland, Rangers, who've been having a fantastic season. They knocked them out.
Mm.
They've been unbeaten at home. They've beaten big teams over the last few seasons. They've not lost at home to teams like Real Madrid, right? So to go there and win 4-0 in a highly pressurized game... And remember, the momentum was always Slavia Prague after they scored that last-minute goal at the Emirates.
Mm.
That was very, very impressive by Arsenal.
Like, it was so comfortable. Like, we were sitting, watching the stream, enjoying sweets and talking about the old days. And that's when you know a game's comfortable, when we just start singing and reminiscing. And I never expected to be in that kind of mood during the stream. I thought it would be edgy. We're on the edge of our seats and... just drama and like, oh, please don't do this to me. I don't know how much my heart can take it. But it was just one of the most comfortable games we've had all season. And that was down to the performance. It wasn't down to the fact that Slavia Prague weren't a good side. It was the fact that we just came out of the traps like a steam train and they just did not know what hit them.
Blew them away.
Completely. And this is the biggest issue that we've had this season is our finishing. Not taking chances.
Well, you know, we saw that in the first leg.
Yeah, it's just let us down so many times throughout the course of this season. How many times or how many points have we dropped because of missed chances?
Mm.
You know, and so, yeah, like a spell of 6 minutes and three goals was just... And then you got Smith Rowe that had one in there as well. So really, it was four goals in, like, I think it was about 8-9 minutes. That was like the old days.
It's devastating.
Like, do you remember the days when we was playing at Highbury with like our proper team that we had back then? And we used to blow teams away by half time and then just chill the rest of the game, bring Henry and everyone off, right? You're ready for the Champions League game in midweek. Yeah, we've dealt with you now. That was what that was like in terms of its devastation. It was just get out of our way. And then in the second half, I'd say it's a game of two halves because I felt that in the first half you saw... like pure devastation, lethal finishing. And then in the second half, I saw composure and calmness. And they went out and said, look, we don't need to go out of second gear. We don't need to overexert ourselves. We've got a game at the weekend. Let's be sensible.
Just manage the game.
Just see it out. If we get the opportunity to get another, great.
It was, I felt it in that second half, the orders were keep a clean sheet.
Yeah.
Just go out there, keep a clean sheet. Mm-hmm. And yeah, that's what they did. They
exactly.
went out there, kept a clean sheet. They got the fourth goal.
Mm-hmm.
Lovely finish by Lacazette. Great control. He's looking really sharp at the moment.
Yeah.
And then, you know, could have even had a fifth. Martinelli was through.
Yeah,
great
that was
run.
That was great.
Just wide. It was just like absolutely emphatic.
Listen, you, every kind of, you know, praise that you can give towards the team and the manager and everything, it's justified in this, you know, instance. And that is probably the best performance of the season, given the magnitude of the game. You know,
yeah,
let's
cause
not
it's, that
what
game's
it.
Do or die.
Yeah.
Do it for the players. Season's over if you lose that game out of the Europa League. Nothing to play for. A few dead games from now till the end of the season. The likelihood of getting even into the top six is difficult.
Yeah.
Not impossible, but that would, you know, right?
Yeah.
So that was do or die for the players. Mm-hmm. And for Mikel Arteta.
Huge.
You know, as I said, there were a lot of people, even people that have been backing him, that were saying, yeah, you know what? If you go out to Slavia Prague, you got to go. We, you know, how can you get out to Slavia Prague, finish outside the top six?
Do you know what?
You have to get sacked.
Do you know what else I think that people are forgetting is that that was a game where we didn't have Tierney, Aubameyang, and Odegaard available.
Or Luis.
Or David Luis, yeah.
Yeah.
So there's four players.
Four of your, when you look at it that way, right? You know, I'd say our best, most reliable centre-back this season, and it sounds weird to say, it has been Luis. He's been the guy that's, he's always, other people have partnered around him, haven't they? Luis has been the starter,
yeah.
Right? Kieran Tierney, we all know, has been having an excellent season. He's our only left-back, really. Well, Granit Xhaka done brilliantly, but he's our left-back,
yeah.
Right? You know, Odegaard, who's coming, has been amazing since he's come in. He was missing. And as you said, Aubameyang's the guy that last year got us those goals that, you know, got us into, you know, got us winning a trophy and it's been the mainstay for the past couple of seasons scoring the goals. So you're right. Missing the four key players.
Yeah.
And still doing a job like that. There other players really stepped up. And we just mentioned there, Granit Xhaka, who dropped in as a left back and he was brilliant.
Mate, do you know what the thing is? Like, I've never known a player at Arsenal. I'm trying to think, and I can't genuinely think. There may be someone, but I can't think of a player that divides an opinion at the club like Granit does. Like, it's always down the middle. You either love him or you hate him. It's like Marmite, innit? And it's like, you know, I backed Granit from years ago, and I lost it with him. It was the Burnley game when I was like, I've had enough. Because another stupid moment cost us the game against Burnley with that sending off. And it was just like, you're never going to learn. You just, what's the point in backing you anymore when you just don't learn? Because it wasn't one mistake and one sending off and one stupid thing. It was just an accumulation of it over and over and over. But then since that Burnley game, he's come back and he's kept his head down and he's probably been our most consistent player. And yes, there was a mistake against Burnley when we played away. But again, it's an incident where he hasn't, you know, gone into his shell. Hasn't, you know, gone.
He doesn't hide, does he?
No, he doesn't. He owns it. And immediately he came out and said, my fault. My error. No, he shouldn't be doing it. Nine times out of ten, he receives that ball from Burnley against Burnley and he instantly turns it round to the right-hand side to David Luiz, who's out. That one instant was when he decided to take a touch and then did something that cost us the goal. So, look, listen, man, being asked to go and play that's not, like, if you're a defender, for example, you should be able to help out and cover in a defensive area. If you're, like, across the defence because you're used to the defensive unit. If you're a midfielder, you should be able to play left or right or centre or a bit deeper, a bit further forward because you know the midfield kind of area. But to ask a central midfielder to go and play in a left-back position, and it's not friendly, it's not like, there will be question marks the other day because, oh, it's Sheffield United. Okay, yeah, Sheffield United. They're already down and everything else. And I didn't think he was going to put him there. because I felt that we needed Granite in the middle because the intensity was going to be greater than what it was against Sheffield United. But two things about that is, firstly, credit to Danny Ceballos.
He had a great game.
For coming into that midfield next to Thomas Partey.
Did and, brilliantly.
And being able to say, okay, you don't miss Granite there.
No, he's brilliant.
And then Ceballos. And then Granite himself for going there and being disciplined. And we watched the video. I know we moan about training videos and goals and all this kind of stuff. The one good thing from this pandemic, and I really like watching, is this open mic thing during the games where they pick a player and you literally follow their game and you can see what goes on. And they've done Granite for Sheffield United. He hasn't got the armband, but he acts like a captain on the pitch. And you don't need an armband to be a captain.
He Wenger, Unai Emery, now Arteta, also Ljungberg as well.
Trust him.
He was in every team. Fans would be there going, why is Xhaka playing, losing it? All those managers always had him in the team, right? So they see something there that we don't see. And I think there are, even despite the fact that he lost it that time and threw down his shirt and stuff like that, where he lost the captaincy, you can see he's a natural leader on the pitch amongst the other players. He's always talking. It does hurt him when he makes mistakes. He makes too many in the times that he's been here. Let's have it right. But you can see it. He's that sort of player, a bit like Jordan Henderson. I'm not saying he's as effective as Jordan Henderson, but a bit like Jordan Henderson or Milner at Liverpool. These guys that the manager knows, if I ask him to play left back, right back, centre forward, even if I tell him to go in goal, he'll do it. He'll do it for the team. He's a team guy, right? You can see that the other players like him. They get on with him, right? So, and he done a job. He done a job. And he's going to be important now from now till the end of the season, because Tierney's probably not going to return. Maybe might return. I mean, it'd be great if he could get, if we get the final and Tierney could be back. But he might have to fill in that position. And he did brilliantly. And another player as well that I think, you know, should get a mention, and it was another surprising selection, was Callum Chambers. Remember, he kept out the two established right backs.
Yeah, I know.
In Bellerin, right? No place for Bellerin, no place for Cedric. He goes, remember, the most important game of the season. He goes with Callum Chambers.
Oh, no.
Not those two. Again, brave decision by the manager.
It was.
Because if it goes wrong now, everyone's going to be like, oh, well, what? You've got two right backs. You got brave decision, but he was excellent. And to me, maybe not going forward as good as those two, although I think his delivery is better than Bellerin's. But certainly defensively, I think he's better than those two defensively.
He offers something different. It's like, obviously, I think that it's very evident the right back position is something that we're going to address in the summer. It's so obvious now. Bellerin, I don't think he's even second choice anymore. I think he's third. That's how far he's dropped down. And I think even Mikel Arteta, you know, has disowned his own son now. And he's like, no. But yeah, listen, his performance was really good. Really good. And I to think come back,
you know, when you compare Chambers to Bellerin in that in the right back position, I think obviously going forward, Bellerin offers more, right?
You
know,
Bellerin offers more going forward.
I think Bellerin's a guy that he can run at players. He can, you know.
When's the last time he did it?
Yeah, he doesn't do it enough, but he can do it, right? But I think defensively, definitely Chambers is more solid. He's harder to get round. He's harder to take on. In, you know, in a one-on-one situation, I'd rather there be Chambers than Bellerin.
Yeah, I get it. Yeah, I'd rather...
And Cedric.
I'd rather Gus Caesar than Hector Bellerin. That's going way back for some people. Do you know what I mean? Listen, at the end of the day, you know my thoughts on it. It's just... Yeah, like, look, listen, Callum's been really good. And to come back from, you know, such a serious injury and to push his way past established players...
Yeah.
To now be
at
in the
business
reckoning.
End of the season. Because in January, a lot of people are thinking, well, he's going to be one of those off as well.
Get him out on loan and then in the summer we'll get some money.
Yeah.
And, you know, ultimately, look, we'd be honest about it. Going forward, Callum Chambers is not going to be the right back for Arsenal if we want to get to where we want to go to. That's the harsh reality. This is the world of football. If you want to be at the elite level, you've got to have elite level players. He's not going to be elite. But what he is like, he does the job.
Would you keep him as a squad player, though? Because remember, yeah, when he can play other areas. Yeah, when he's on loan at Fulham, he played as a defensive midfielder, got their player of the season.
Yeah, he did.
Right? He was playing as a centre-back for us. I remember before he got injured, he was the best centre-back.
Yeah, he's very versatile. You know? Yeah. So as long as, look, it's all down to Callum Chambers as well. Given his age and everything, the time that he's missed because of injury, does he want to be a squad player? Mm. Or does he want to be first choice? I think that if he ultimately wants to be a first choice player and that's not going to be at Arsenal, then the years that he's been here, wish him well and off you go, get a bit of money and wish him well with the rest of his career. But, you know, moving forward, like right now, okay, great. It's fine. He's the best of the bad, I'd say best of a bad bunch, you know, out of that group. But yeah, next season's next season. We know what we want to do. But for now, yeah, he's earned the right to play in that position. And it was another really good performance from him.
Smith Rowe.
Excellent.
Brilliant again, Smith Rowe. Absolutely amazing performance by him.
Superb. And look, it's just a shame he wasn't available at the start of the season because he was injured. And a lot of people keep, you know, forgetting that when they say, why didn't Arteta bring him in earlier? We needed a 10. If he weren't playing that, we was injured. What do you want him to do? Go out on his crutches. So we had to wait. And Mikel was, I still think he's vindicated in his decision of not playing Ozil. Because I think that when you watch Odegaard and Smith Rowe in that position, they do other parts of the job that are required that Mesut doesn't.
Yeah,
Listen, at the end of the day, it's ended, it's finished, it's over. We don't need to speak about it. But I will forever be grateful for some of the things that Mesut Ozil's done here. And in terms of creative playmaker, it's one of the best I've ever seen. Like, don't even get what happened at the end of his career to overshadow what he was as a player. And phenomenal. But now it's different times. We've moved on. It's something different. The game's evolved as well. Number 10s don't just play as a number 10 anymore. You've got to play as an 11, a 7, a 9, an 8. You're all over the place. And when you watch Smith Rowe, 1 minute he's picked up and he's on the right-hand side. 5 minutes later, he's on the left-hand side. Then he's in a 10. Then he can be like a false 9. Then he's dropped deep and he's in an 8. That's what that position needs you to do.
You've got to work.
You've got to be able to create.
His work rate, his pressing, his, you know what I mean? Everything. Pressing players into mistakes.
Everything.
Harassing players, you know what I mean? Aggression.
Do you know what I mean?
He plays with so much aggression.
Oh, loads. Look, the one thing I don't think people quite understand yet is that he's still got to grow into his body, if that makes sense. He's still a kid in some respects. So he's going to get stronger, you know, physically better. And people see that what I've noticed with him this season in particular is after about 70 minutes, he starts to look really tired. But that's because of the amount of work that he actually does. He probably easily covers 10K a game. So when you look as he gets older and develops and plays more, then he will be conditioned to play that for 90 minutes. Do you know what I mean? So he's just everything that he does, man. He just, what I like about these youngsters at the club, and it's not just Smith Rowe, is that they look like they're just playing like down the park.
They're hungry.
But it's like they're playing in the park, Robbie. Like their mates have just knocked on the door and just said, do you want to come for a kick around down the park? And they're over Hackney Marshes and just having a kick around. Because it doesn't look like they're playing for Arsenal Football Club in European quarterfinals, and it's like they're just come on, let's just go out and have a laugh. And what they've done this season as a collective, a load of these youngsters, is embarrass so many senior players and show where we've got so many gaping holes and where the problems are. So, you know, Smith Rowe, Saka, all these young boys, it's just, they've been a breath of fresh air, man.
They've been amazing. You said it in your interview after the game. You said about the irony of the fact that, you know, and, you know, there was the racism incident and we found out that that guy, Kadela, their Slavia Prague player, got banned for 10 games.
Listen, Robbie, don't even get me started on that, man, because you might have to cut the...
Well, let's talk slightly about that, but the irony of it, as you said, black players.
All
the players who scored the goals were black.
Yeah.
And also Lacazette, I don't know if you've seen the pictures.
Oh, it's what
where
an image.
He just basically, where they sort of stood in a little
huddle. It literally went right up in front of them.
He went right in front of them, went down on one knee.
Just stared
held
at
his, and he stared at the whole Slavia Prague team. And there's another celebration where Pepe lifts up, you know,
arm in the air.
His arm in the air of Lacazette, almost in that black power type, signifying that they wanted to beat Slavia Prague.
They were on a mission.
Those players, they were, that was in their mind, wasn't it?
Yeah,
what happened with that Cadella and Glenn Kamara?
Of course it was.
Those players, Lacazette, you could see it on him. Because he was sharp in the game and he was determined to beat Slavia Prague.
Do you know what that reminded me of when he was kneeled down like that in front of them? It reminded me of something like the New Zealand Haka. Mm. You know when they stand in front of their opposition and they just...
Yeah.
And they do the Haka and they're like in their face. It was a similar type of thing to that where Lacazette was just... Because he didn't have to be that close.
No.
But he just stood there and just... And it was just the look.
He stared at the whole team. He's just like looking and saying, yeah.
And I think he was probably looking at the black players within the Slavia Prague team and thinking like, I feel you because I know you're in a situation that you probably can't get out of. And we've all discussed this. Like, why don't they say something? Or we're not in their shoes.
Mm.
We don't live there. You imagine living there, given the fact of what their ultras are like and the certain fans. We saw the banner that came out after the Rangers game from the ultras over there.
Mm.
It's no exaggeration when you say that if they spoke out, their life would probably be in
There'd
danger.
There'd be targets as well, yeah.
So,
there'd be targets.
You know, how must they feel? 10 games, Robbie, come on, man. I've seen play. Kieran Trippier's got a longer ban for betting.
Yep.
It's not condoning betting, but I'm trying to say what's the worst? Betting irregularities or racism?
UEFA, when it comes to these issues, I'm sorry, they're a joke.
They're a joke. They banned Glenn Kamara as well for 3 games for retaliation. You should have been giving him a medal. You should have been, like, how are you giving him a 3-game ban because he's retaliated because somebody has racially abused him?
Let me say, when I look at this thing, right, I look on it, number one, UEFA, 10-game ban is not enough for me. Should have got longer than that.
Mm-hmm.
Should have got way longer than that, right? Should have to go on some sort of...
like, kick it out.
Some sort of course or something because I'm a strong believer in, as well, in that don't just say massive ban and that's it, leave it. You've also got to teach that player the reasons why what you said is so hurtful, right? So there should be that. But then I also look at the club, Slavia Prague, as well, because I don't think nobody has really said that. I'm looking at the club. It's almost like they're still supporting this guy, right? And a lot of clubs do this. It's not just Slavia Prague. A lot of clubs do this, right? You saw that time with Suarez at Liverpool. Where they, oh no, we still support him. We know him and he ain't, no, hold
They
on.
Came out before a game with his picture
with
T-shirts
on
and
that, which Jamie Carragher, I remember him on TV saying that, you know, they've since really, he really regrets doing that, right? What happens in these cases, the wagons get circled. Oh, he's our guy. He would never be. We know him. No, hold on. He said what he said, right? I just feel that the club, Slavia Prague, what have they done about this?
Nothing. They've gone and put loads of tweets out. That's what they've done.
And that's why, to me, I look on it and I say there should be sanctions for them as well because they should be doing something about it. To me, that player has disgraced Slavia Prague.
Because
not every Slavia Prague fan is a racist.
No, and player.
Not every Slavia Prague player is a racist. But because of his actions,
the whole nation wanted Arsenal to win.
We had the whole nation wanted in this country. Which is very unusual.
Mate, I've even seen Tottenham fans on social media saying, you know what? I'll take that one for knocking them out. I'll deal with that.
Yeah,
Man United fans say it, like posting pictures of Lacazette saying, that's one for us. Like a whole nation, and not just this country, but throughout the world, when you think how global football is now and how global Arsenal are as a following... Yeah. There's a lot of people throughout the world who probably don't know Slavia Prague. Now, they're only knowing of Slavia Prague now.
for that incident
will be racist.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. To me, this is where the club and these clubs miss. Not only are they missing a trick, it shouldn't even be. It shouldn't even be a trick. It should be something that they should be doing naturally, right? This guy Cadella has disgraced the club, right? He has disgraced the club with his actions. Those ultras, which remember, those are a small group of fans within the Slavia Prague fan base, have disgraced the club. Now, somebody at the club should be looking at that and saying, you know what? We got to do something about this. We can't have these ultra guys walking around unveiling banners, you know, backing what Cadella said and calling people the N-word and things like that. We don't want them back. Number one, we don't want you lot back. Cadella, number two, you know, we might have to sell you, or we're gonna give you a further ban, even longer than what those go, because you know that's just not what our club's about. That's what I want to see from Slavia Prague. But if you're there, you're now just backing him, and as I said, they're not the first club. Lots of clubs do it. You know, even fans do it as well. They'll be like, one of their players have been done for racially abusing somebody or whatever. Oh no, he didn't get done in a court of law or this and that. You know what I mean? No, stop backing these people, right? Because ultimately, they're embarrassing the club. If that was an Arsenal player who did what Cadella did, I wouldn't want him to play for Arsenal no more.
Yeah,
I don't care who he is.
Do you know what it is, Robbie?
I wouldn't
as well?
Want him to play, or if he did still play, I want him to be punished and I want him to come out and learn from what he would have done. And any fans that are backing it and saying, no, well, I don't want to be no part of that either. So this is what needs to start happening. I think people are, yes, UEFA weak, as we all know, they always are.
Always
right?
Weak, man.
But it's not just UEFA. When I look on these things, it's not just UEFA. What about the club? And I'm telling you, it's not just Slavia Prague. I've seen it on other clubs do the same thing as well. And as I said, I think it brings, you know, if I was a Slavia Prague fan, I'd feel really bad, because they've now, with those actions of almost like they're backing at Cadella, they make the whole fan base look like they're racist, which obviously, I mean, we did an interview the other day with a Slavia Prague guy. He was cool, right? Not every person from Slavia Prague or the Czech Republic and that is racist. We know that.
But the image and the perception
image,
now.
Because of this guy, the light treatment he's getting, because of the fact that the club haven't really gone in on him,
And listen, Robbie, and the other thing is that clubs will never act until UEFA do something to the clubs. Now, it's not right that you need to go down that pathway for a club to take action. But if UEFA were to turn around, for example, and say to Slavia Prague, like before this tie had even happened from the incident, if they would have dealt with it immediately and said, let's say they would have turned around and went, you're disqualified from the tournament. We found him guilty. As a club, you're disqualified. You're out.
And let's be real. This is not the first time Slavia Prague have had incidents of racism.
But if that happens, Robbie, they get kicked out of the whole tournament.
Mm.
You're telling me they wouldn't act? You're telling me?
Of course, this is what needs to happen. Because if these sort of things start happening, they'll get their act together, these clubs. If, you know what I mean, there's a lot of clubs that turn around and say, well, there's not a lot we can do because the ultras, they're so powerful and that. No, hold on. If you hit them in their pocket, if you say to Slavia Prague, well, you know what, you're out of Europe. Till you sort yourself out. A bit like what they've done to the English clubs.
Yeah.
Back in the day.
Yeah.
When, you know, the English clubs had a serious hooliganism problem.
Yeah.
They said to them, you're out of Europe. Yeah. Remember, we were supposed to go into Europe.
Yeah. That was after Heysel.
After Heysel.
Yeah.
They like, and
then,
you know,
the English teams got banned.
And not just banned for a year, banned for a few years. It was basically quite a few. Basically, the ban was until you get your act together.
And then, if I remember rightly, we won the league at Anfield in 89 and we would have been in the European Cup the following season, but English teams were banned.
Exactly. And basically, the ban was until you get your act together, you're not welcome.
Yeah, you're not welcome.
Why is it not the same now with what's going
exactly.
on?
Exactly.
Why? How do you get repeat offenders year in, year out? It's the
it's
same.
Always
even
the
over
time,
here,
same
even
people.
Over here in the UK, it's the same clubs all the time, a lot of times. Year in, year out here, this excuse and that excuse, and Do you know what? We've done some stuff in the community. No. If you start hitting these clubs, you start hitting these clubs where it really hurts, like what you just said. You say, yo, you know what, bro?
Done.
You're not welcome until you sort your problem out.
You're not playing in the European competition. So until next season,
you're
banned.
You sort your problem out, you're not welcome in this competition.
Mm-hmm.
They will sort themselves out.
Oh,
when they start to get hit in the pocket.
Of course they'll sort themselves out. Of course they will. But the thing is, and like we said, we answered that in the best possible way. You know, 4 goals, 3 black players scored. And I remember as well yesterday, and it made me laugh because I even said it at the time. And I completely forgot. But I said about Emil Smith-Rowe scoring.
Mm.
And it was disallowed because he's white. Well, he's actually not white.
No, he's a mixed race.
Yeah. But I think that the officials and everyone thought he was white. They didn't realise his background. So they did that. That is why they disallowed the goal. But that's obviously why. But it's like, at the end of the day, look, listen.
But the irony of it was.
It is just pure irony. And I said to you, I said, if there was... with the scoreline the way it was, I would have took every white player off in the second half and brought a black player on. And it was, I don't know. I know we've got the young lad that's been travelling a few times with us.
The goalkeeper. Yeah, yeah.
And I don't know if he was there, but I said, if we needed to make the numbers up, I'd have took Leno off and put Willian in goal. And I would have just finished with a 1-11 of black players.
Mm.
And then we would have scored and all of them just stand there. That would have just been the image of the decade. Yeah. That would have been just poetic. But we answered, look, we kicked them out. We kicked racism out. And like you said, look, I do feel sorry for some of them because they're not all racist.
Yeah, this is the thing. You feel sorry for some of those Slavia Prague fans, right? Because they're not all racist, right? And now their club's getting being tarred as a racist club.
Yeah.
Right? And that's because of that player.
Yeah.
And some of the club's
actions. And
some of those individuals that, you know, and it's not just Slavia Prague that are around football clubs. And we got to stop backing and, you know, when racism is there, we call it out. It doesn't matter if it's our own fans.
Robbie,
I don't care. If it's an Arsenal fan, I'm calling him out. I don't care.
Do you know what the thing is, Robbie? Yeah. Is that, we're privileged in a sense that we come from a country that's and football in general and Arsenal as a club, where we've been so diverse in terms of its support and fans from the 80s, you know, black fans, black players and everything else. And I can't ever experience racism like you would or stuff like that, but I'm not going to name where we went to, but I remember going to a European game with you before, and it was to an Eastern European venue. And I remember we got off the coach and there was you, there was Tao, and there was me. So I'm the only white person there. We walked up this alleyway from the coach and we sort of stopped and went, look behind us. And there's about 4 or 5 coppers just following us all the way from the coach. Every other fan has just walked off, gone where they want. But they walked with us and we were like, why are you following us? And then one of them was mentioning that it's, we're just for your safety sort of thing. What do you mean for our safety? And then we went to this restaurant and it was this outside thing. And it's the first time I've ever experienced it when I'm sitting there and I genuinely felt like everybody was looking at us.
Mm.
And the reason why was because of you and Tao, because you're black. And that is the first time when I've sat there and felt why is everyone looking at us? Do you know what I mean? And that for me, that was whoa.
It happens. It happens here too.
Of course.
And you know, we've still got a long way to go here as well, you know? You know, a friend of mine the other day was saying to me before the Slavia Prague thing, was saying, oh, well, at least at Arsenal, we don't have that. I said, yo, bro, I'm sorry.
You still have it.
It's not as nowhere near as bad. I think Arsenal do great things. I think our fan base on the whole.
So diverse.
It's great.
As well.
It's so diverse. You know, you don't go to Arsenal really and see stuff like that, but there's still some individuals. I mean, I know I've got a friend of mine who's Jewish. Mm-hmm. He was at a game in Southampton just before the Southampton away, just before the lockdown, and there was an Arsenal fan right in front of him. Pure anti-Semitic remarks. He asked the guy, "Can you stop, please? I'm actually Jewish," because they were at a kiosk in, you know, at half time.
Mm.
And the guy's saying to the people behind there, making all these anti-Semitic remarks. And my friend asked him and said, touched him and said, "Yo, you stop that, yeah? I don't like that. I'm Jewish." He looked around at him and he just kept going. And thankfully, a steward heard him. Police came. They arrested that fan. That fan went to court and has been done.
Wow.
Has been done for racism. So that's an Arsenal fan. So when people say, "Oh no, it don't exist at all," listen, every single club, obviously we don't have it on the scale, and that's what when you're saying it's not on the scale of what you see.
Nobody at any clubs are angels. It wasn't very long ago that we were singing, I'm not saying we, I'm saying Arsenal as a club, like fans, were singing derogatory songs about Adebayor's mum.
Yeah. Yeah.
And certain things.
Yeah. So we've come a long way. We've come a long way in this country. We've still got a long way to go. But there has to be something done about some of these clubs that basically, they just sweep it under the carpet.
And it's broader as well,
they just turn around and say, we know Cadella, he wouldn't do that. Yeah. No, sorry. You know,
the racist side of things broader as well, though, Robbie, because it's not about whether you call a black person the N-word.
Mm.
Like you said, anti-Semitic. There's also like, you know, like people know my oldest son.
Mm.
He's a traveller.
Mm.
Like some of the things that, like, he's got called before. Mm. The P word that they use. It's racism.
Mm.
So it is. So it's just, you know? But little things. And we've come from a culture of...
Yeah,
and those are the songs on the terraces.
Yeah, we still need to see more. There's still lots of things.
With the Y word.
Yeah, the Y word. You know, there's many things, man. I'm so happy that Arsenal's fan base is diverse, but there's a lot of other fan bases that ain't. You know what I mean? I go to certain parts of the country, you know, I don't know, maybe you go to a Bradford or something like that. How many Asian fans are there in the crowd? But if you look at the demographics of the place, there should be loads of Asian fans there, but they're not there. So are they doing enough to get them into games? You know what I mean? So there's lots of issues. I mean, it's turned into a wider thing now, but I was just so glad that those Arsenal players as well, you know, and the symbolism of a Lacazette, that was absolutely amazing.
Yeah.
And emphatic win. Now,
we
are through to the next round. Semi-finals against Villarreal, Unai Emery.
Oh.
That's the matchup. Our matchup today is that Mikel Arteta and Unai Emery. You know that going into that game, that's what it's going to be. It's going to be comparison. You know what them stats we've been seeing all season? After this amount of games, Emery won this and Arteta's won that.
Get ready for loads and loads of votes. It's going to be headaches. It's going to be a week of hell over those two legs. And it's like, look, I'm going to say this very clear now. I haven't got nothing against Unai Emery as a person because, you know, listen, I'm going to be straight with this. The one thing I give him credit for and respect for is that he's not left the club and slated us. He's not gone off and started bad-mouthing us, and he's just gone about his business, as it were. But I want us to go and make him suffer for what he made us suffer. And it's like, Robbie, man, come on, man. And it was like, I'm going to try and break this down, but when he joined Arsenal, it was the first time we've had a different manager in 21 years. All right, it was new, it was exciting, it was a new era had dawned upon us. We hear all these great things, and I saw a man that came in that couldn't speak English, but he tried. He really tried to bridge a gap between like the fans. Because the last thing he wanted was to come in with question marks, let's be honest, because no one was expecting Unai Emery. It came very left field at the last minute. That he didn't want a translator there and he couldn't really communicate with the fans. He wanted to try and show that he really wants to be a part of it. So I respected that from the beginning. And the whole good evening thing was never malice in that it was like an endearment, if anything.
No, it wasn't.
No, it was funny. No, towards the end, it was annoying. But it was funny. it was funny when you used to do it, because every time without fail, we'd come into his interview, sit down, good evening. It could be morning and he would say good evening. Do you know what I mean? Mm. But it was like, and then there was that period at the very beginning where we went 20 odd games unbeaten. And we were thinking, wow, life's all right here, isn't it?
We should have got in the top four.
We should have been.
He got us to...
And then, he went and made the decisions he did against Crystal Palace, and he put Cole Jenkinson right back and everything.
Yeah, yeah.
And we completely fell apart. And then you go and look at what we did in that
final.
Got to the final. I wish we never. If you had a choice of getting to that final, day out in Baku and everything, or go out in the quarterfinals, what would you have took?
Oh, get to the final.
Nah, what? Get slapped like that?
Nah,
against Chelsea?
Yeah, it was embarrassing, but you want to get to a final.
Nah, no chance. I'd been to Baku that season already. I didn't need to go back again. I'm back again. Jesus
Listen,
Christ.
When you start doing the comparisons, though, his record's better than...
No, it ain't. Arteta's won a trophy.
Yeah, but his overall record...
So there's your matchup. Arteta
won.
His
overall record.
Emery nil.
Last year, his league record, though, was better than... Arteta's
having to repair his mess and Wenger's.
It's a bit harsh.
No, it ain't.
Because he was trying to repair the same mess as well. He knew Ozil weren't the answer.
He contributed to a lot of it as well.
No, he wanted to get rid of those guys, but he didn't get the backing like what Arteta got, where he was able to leave those out. Because remember, he was leaving out Ozil at first and we were playing better. And then all of a sudden, he sort of brought him back into the fold. You know, he had the Mustafis and all those players. We weren't able to get rid of them. You know,
I think
did he have enough time at Arsenal?
Well, look, did he have enough time? He couldn't have gone on any further because he had clearly lost the dressing room, like completely and utterly. You remember that game when we lost in the Europa League, ironically?
At Frankfurt.
It was, wasn't it? Yeah, we'd lost that game. And like we was at that point, it was like, nah. No. And it was just building and building and building. It was getting worse and worse.
I think with what happened with him, is like you said, he came in and he was very good.
He tried
good.
To be authoritative.
I think he did very, very well at first. And we should have got into a top four that season. Yeah. And he did blow it. We had an easy run in Palace, Brighton. We blew all of those games.
Yeah.
We got outside the top four. So first of all, and then he had another chance. He had a second chance to redeem himself by winning the final. Right, we went into that as almost like favourites, and we got battered in that final. Four goals, you know, 4-1. It was embarrassing defeat, and then they still gave him another chance.
Yeah,
and then he went into the next season, and he was that season was terrible.
It was awful.
We were playing, and I think as well the style of football was poor. We can't use the excuses of no fans and things like that, because there were fans.
Robbie, we
the
were
football
conceding
was diabolical.
30 plus shots per game.
Yeah, it was terrible. It was terrible.
Do you know what I mean? Do you remember when I really started to realise when I went, something's not right in the way we're playing? Do you remember Watford away? I think we went 2-0 up, didn't we?
Yeah.
And then in that second half, they
battered us. Yeah, yeah.
And I was like, what the hell has just happened here?
And I think the thing is as well, there was no style of play.
There weren't anything.
It was, you're like, what are we doing? Are we attacking? Are we defensive? Are we, you know, what style of play? It was dead. He had to go. He's gone to Villarreal though, and he's not been doing too bad.
Seventh.
There was a lot of people at first saying how great he was doing in the league, but looking at the league table,
they've drawn like 13
at the moment.
Games.
They've won 11 games, they've drawn 13,
yeah,
they've lost six. So
they've lost their last two.
Yeah, but he draws a lot of games. He used to do that at Arsenal as well, right? But he is through to the semi-finals. He is good in this competition. He's won it three times. He's got to a final with us.
Yeah, cheers.
He's got an outstanding record in this competition, and we got to get past him.
Do you know what someone said to me earlier today? They said to me, how are we going to beat Unai Emery when he's got such an unbelievable record in this competition? And do you know what my answer was? The same way Chelsea did. That was a final.
Yep.
And they humiliated us.
Yep.
Listen,
it's
going to be a very, very interesting tactically to see how their minds work. What's Arteta got up his sleeve for Emery? Arteta was assistant and quite influential in Man City and some of the things that they did when they came to the Emirates and beat us under Unai Emery. And I remember there was one scene when I think Man City scored and it was Pep Guardiola and one of the other assistants went up to Arteta and hugged him like they'd planned something and it had worked. Now, obviously, Man City have got a level of players that are, you know what I mean? But it's, I'm really looking forward to it tactically to see how it matches up.
I was looking at his comments. And let's remember, they beat Dinamo Zagreb, who knocked out Tottenham. 3-1 on aggregate, so, you know, 1-2-1 in the second leg. And Emery was asked about the tie, and he said, first of all, I'm used to meeting ex-teams, so playing Arsenal where I coached is nothing new as an experience. He said, we'll face up to it with humility, pride and responsibility. This is a chance to establish Villarreal on the top rung of European football. This is Villarreal's fifth semi-final in Europe, yeah? When we got to the finals of the Champions League, Villarreal. Who did we beat?
Villarreal. Actually, we got Colo Torre scored at Emirates and we drew 0-0 away. Yeah. And Jens Lehmann exactly. saved the penalty from Riquelme.
They do have some good players, Villarreal. Oh, yeah, you massively. Know what I mean? You know, you've got to look at it. There's some very, very good players. Alcacer up front is a top player. He's a good finisher. Par Torres... Mm-hmm. A lot of clubs have been looking at him in defence. You know, he's been very, very good this season.
When I watched their games, there's one guy. Turn it around so I can see it because I can't pronounce
it's
his name.
It's Foyth as well, Tottenham.
Oh, mate. Remember? It was this guy here, Chuck Wheezy. I think that's pronounced Chuck Wheezy.
Yeah, he's good.
I think he's Nigerian.
Yeah.
But I've watched a bit of him. Rapid.
Yeah.
He is rapid. And I think it was in the Dinamo game. I think he hit the woodwork a couple of times in the second leg. But he was one player when I was watching and I was like,
Moreno and Alcacer, you know.
Moreno's good.
Good players. Who else plays for them? Arsenal, ex-Arsenal?
Gabriel, is it? No. No, he came from there. Wait there. My mind's gone black. Gabriel's a
there's an ex-Tottenham player in Foyth. They've also got...
Gabriel's at Valencia, isn't he?
Yeah, he's an Arsenal player. Ex-Arsenal player.
Where did I get Gabriel from? Did he sign for us from them? Or was it... Who the hell went there? Was it Santi that went there?
Santi went there. Santi was there. But he's not playing for them now.
I can't think, you know.
You guys guessed it out there?
I can't think who's at Villarreal who's played there.
Ex-Arsenal
did
player.
Did he play in the second leg?
Huh?
Did he play in the second leg?
Yep. Midfielder. Holding midfielder.
Not Coquelin.
Coquelin.
No way.
Yeah. He's at Villarreal. He came on as a sub last night.
Oh, that's why I didn't watch it towards the end.
Yeah.
No, I didn't really.
So Emery, Coquelin, Foyth from Tottenham.
Mate. You know
I mean? But listen, it's going to be a tough game, but this is a big chance for Mikel Arteta to get through. The thing is, right, yes, Unai Emery has a great record in this competition. Mm-hmm. But let's not forget, last season against all odds, Arteta. You know, getting to... You know, and you got to say, we beat better teams.
Yeah, Man City
to win
in the
FA
semi-final
Cup.
Were better than
Man City in the semi-final and Chelsea in the final.
Do you know what? Do you know the thing that I watched, right? When I watched their semi-final against Dinamo, you know the lad who scored the hat-trick against Spurs? He scored their goal. He could have had 3 or 4. What the bit that I looked at was the very quick, intricate play in and around the box, the 1-2 touch that we can do. That seemed to really hurt Villarreal. So I think we need to be wary of their pace. So that might be something
which
where
you're going to have to be. If we play like how we played the other night.
Oh, we could be able to beat them.
Yeah.
Easily. And playing away first, I think that we need to, I want to see at least 2 goals minimum away from home.
We need a couple of goals, definitely. Or we need, you know, we can't afford to just go there. Again, this is what he's good at, is keeping clean sheets and stuff like that. Draws.
Yeah.
Really to go there and get a result. Looking forward to that game. It's a game at the weekend, but just before we touch on our game at the weekend, which is against Fulham, 1:30 kickoff on Sunday, the Aubameyang news that came out, that he's got malaria.
Man.
Now,
mad, isn't
it? You know, there's a lot of people during the week saying things like, oh, well, you know, there's nothing wrong with him. He's falling out with the manager. It's all these rumours circulating.
Some people funny are comparing enough, him to Ozil again.
Yeah, funny enough, I did hear from somebody, right? that he'd gone to her, my source, right? My source was he'd been admitted to hospital and put on a special ward. And I was thinking to myself, when I heard that, I go, oh, he must have COVID. So that's what I heard earlier in the week. Turns out he's got malaria, which is not a great thing to have.
That takes a while to recover. Yeah, some people.
Some people, it can knock you out for a long time. He said in his post that, you know, he's not been feeling well for the past couple of weeks and didn't really know what it was, right? And now we know, you know, and that will affect anybody's game, malaria, you know. He got it whilst he was away on duty with Gabon. His international duty thing ain't really served us well. Odegaard got that knock. He's been out.
Yeah.
Now, you know, our captain's got malaria, you know. You know, Tierney played a load of the games for Scotland, came back, you know. That international break has not been kind to us at all. But, yeah, you know, get well soon to Aubameyang. Yeah,
perfect antidote, wasn't it?
And you know what? We could do with getting him back, even if it's for, you know, one of those legs, you know. And if we could get to the final, you need a player like him in and around the place. But at the weekend, Fulham. Also the scene of probably one of our best performances of the season. Earlier on in the season.
First game, we
played Fulham and we was getting enthusiastic after that. Remember Willian masterclass?
Willian masterclass. We were like, yep,
three assists.
None since.
No, he's had assists since.
Yeah, I know. I'm really joking. But
Fulham, yeah. Of course, Fulham are fighting for their lives. They're looking in big relegation trouble.
Do you know they'll
be fresh as well. And they have beaten some top teams, they've given a lot of top teams trouble, and they will. When I've watched them play, they're very dynamic.
Yeah.
So it won't be an easy game now.
No, it won't be, but do you know what it is? I would say that Fulham have got themselves back in a rut.
Yeah,
that they've
the
got
past
them,
couple of games, they've...
Like, they got themselves out of it when they won at Anfield and everything else. Yeah. And you were thinking, wow, they could really be the ones to get them out of like that area, and it would be Newcastle or Brighton or whatever. And then they've just hit a bad run of form at the worst possible time. I'd say in that relegation area, the informed team's probably West Brom.
Yeah.
Given their last couple of results.
West Brom and it was...
You know, West Brom can now overtake Fulham and have a game in hand on them.
Yeah, I was just looking at
so
it.
So that just shows like
they're
how...
only two points off Fulham now.
And also
Newcastle, they had that huge win and they've got a game in hand on Fulham as well.
Yeah.
Fulham have to beat us, really.
They have to.
There's a lot of pressure on them. So they're going to be coming. They're going to be up for this game. Are we going to be up for it after...
We should be.
You know, after the game that we've just had, you know, could you, you know...
How could you not
want to see those players drop off, do you?
No, how could you not have some kind of momentum from that performance? And also now, as a player, you should be sitting there going, you know what? European semi-final.
Mm.
Two games away from a European final. I want to be a part of that.
Mm.
I want to play. I don't want to be sat on the bench. I don't want to just collect a medal and do nothing. I want that.
Yep.
So if you can't raise your levels, then what I expect to see is, you know, because the league is an outside thing at the moment with no pressure, in my opinion, there's no pressure in it at all. I think that, you know, given the games as well, we've had harder games after European games. We played Leicester straight after a European game. We beat them. We played Spurs straight after a European game and beat them. We also had Manchester City straight after a Europa League game, lost. But, you know, so this is a more favourable, should we say. We just had Sheffield United before the game. We've got Fulham now. You know, we've got Everton after that, and they've very kindly moved it to the Friday night, which means we get a nice long break before we have to go to Villarreal. So the games have been... There's no pressure on them, man. I don't think we need to make wholesale changes.
Well, I'm going to ask you your team.
Okay.
Right, so let's look at your 11 in goal.
I'd put Matt Ryan in goal. Honestly, I'll give him an opportunity now.
Yeah,
I don't think there's no pressure in the Premier League.
Why not give him... I'd play him as well.
We don't know whether he's going to stay here at the end of the season.
Give him a game.
He had a game against Villa that time. I thought he had a really good game.
I'd play him as well. Right back.
I'll bring Cedric in.
Not Bellerin? He didn't play at all the other night?
Nope. Maybe the under-23s have got a game.
All right. Let me see what team we got. Who's left back then?
Probably play Granit though again. Won't change that.
Okay.
Granit is one player within the team that's like an engine. Like, he played 16 games in a row, 90 minutes each game.
All right, your two centre-backs.
probably Rob Holding, because he hasn't played a lot of football lately. He's only just come back into the side, so he should be fine. And then I'd probably stick with Mary, actually. I'd keep that partnership going.
Okay.
I wouldn't change that up. And again, Mary's somebody that's had a rest lately and had a little injury and stuff. So it's not like he's playing game after game after game. Yeah, keep the partnership going. Keep building that.
Midfield?
Yeah, I'll play Partey. I don't think that's a gamble at the moment either because I think that he's showing now that he's fit and he is completing 90 minutes and there's no issues. So Thomas Partey goes in there.
And then next to him?
I think Danny Ceballos still. I think he deserves the opportunity. Again, it's a player that's not been playing a lot lately. So it's not like he's going to be tired. Play him.
Right hand side?
Pepe.
Left hand side?
Martinelli.
Okay. In the middle?
Smith Rowe. Unless Odegaard's back, maybe. Don't know what the situation is, but I think Smith Rowe. And I think we took him off with this game in mind.
And
game
up,
is done.
Up front, I guess.
No, you know what? No, I am going to start Lacazette. And I'll tell you what the reason why I'm going to start Lacazette. I'd be tempted to play Balogun. Give him a run out. Because it's very evident now that the reason why we haven't seen Balogun is because he ain't signed his contract. And now all of a sudden, it's done. He's back in the squad, comes on. Against
For second, but Eddie Nketiah came
but
on
what I'm saying is
him.
The reason why he wouldn't have played is because you imagine Arsenal said, "All right, we'll keep playing him. He scores a load of goals. All of a sudden, he can then demand that money that he wanted initially. Another club can then come in and go, oh, boy, yeah, look at what he's doing." And so Arsenal just kept him to the side and put him in the under-23s and said, "You ain't playing for us until you signed your contract." But I feel that given Lacazette's momentum at the moment, given the fact
he's
that he's scoring goals.
No, leave
and
him
I said,
in.
I think
he's
I said,
scoring
yeah,
goals,
exactly.
Leave
keep
him
in. And I said to you, I think I said to you in my thing after the game, like he's one goal behind Dominic Calvert-Lewin. Like that's
In all competitions, he scored over 20 goals now, 20 goals this season.
There you go.
Yeah. Okay. So no Saka.
No, I'd bring him out. He's had a few knocks the last couple of games.
No, Willian.
No.
Remember, this was the scene of his best performance.
Martinelli
for
plays.
Arsenal.
Martinelli starts. Another chance to get 90 in the tank.
Willian in the number 10? The rest of that Smith Rowe?
Nah. Smith Rowe has had like a few weeks off because he ain't been playing. He got injured on international duty.
Yeah, I think I'm in agreement with that team. I'm not...
Bought Smith Rowe off in that game after about 65 minutes.
Yeah,
and I think he only did that with this in mind.
Possibly Bellerin would come in for me. No. I think I'll put Willian in that number 10 and give Smith Rowe a rest, man, because
He's had a rest.
He's vital.
But he's had a rest.
Yeah, but we've got this game, then we've got the game. If anything, I'll play him against Everton. I'll play him against Everton, then you know what I mean? Because I want... nothing can happen to him. And right? Because if Odegaard's, you know...
Yeah.
And Willian, you know, sometimes when a player knows that they did really well against that team before... that can push them on to do it again.
Behave yourself, man.
Do you remember that game? He was blistering.
Yeah, it was amazing. It was absolutely immense, man. I thought, wow, what an absolute masterstroke. We just signed, like, unbelievable player. But listen, you know, after that first game, he was better than Ziyech. But you know what I mean? You were sitting there after that Fulham game going, "Oi, hey, listen.
Ziyech still ain't done much."
Nah, he hasn't. Right? He hasn't.
But anyway, listen, thanks very much, DT. Thanks for watching and listening to the podcast today. Don't forget, you can download it on all your normal formats. Listen, it's much better than what it could have been, right? Arsenal are through to the semi-finals of the Europa League, where they will take on Unai Emery's Villarreal, a chance to get through to a final where they'll face either Manchester United or Roma. You know, this is starting to look a bit like last season. We're in the league, not great, but we could still finish the season with a trophy. And not just a trophy, a European trophy and a route back into the top four, which financially that would be unbelievable. And, you know, it would change the whole dynamics of the type of player that Arsenal can bring in. So yeah, we could sneak in through the back door, but to do that, we're going to have to continue through with those performances that we saw the other night. Thanks for watching and listening to the podcast. You can download it on all the normal formats. Don't forget the link for Profit Accumulator in the description, and we'll be back next week.